you. Good morning, sir. My sir, thank you for coming. We start with the first talk. We are here to deal with the basics of retinal surgery. And the first talk is by Dr. Sriram, who is currently working as a registrar in Shankarai Hospital, Guntur. He will be telling us about the preparation and instrumentation in VR surgery. Sriram.
So first, I would like to thank my mentors, both present here and those not today here, for making me learn that I am here to present on the basics of VR surgery. My mentor always asks, how do you put an elephant into a refrigerator? So as a fellow, I was thinking why sir is asking, but once we start independent surgeries, we realize unless you know what is the desired outcome and how you are going to get to the desired outcome, you should not start a surgery, because you are going to end up in MS if you don't know the path. So I'll start with preparation of the patient, surgeon factors, and preparation of the OT. Most of the retina cases tend to have systemic issues with like diabetes, with concomitant cardiac, neuro, or nephrological disorders. We should get a heparin-free dialysis, preferably in patients with diabetic vitrectomy who are on dialysis. Preoperative anti-VEGF may help in case of a florid neovascularization. And we have a very low temperature settings in the OT, so a preoperative nebulization in case of asthmatics should help. Even though we take precautions, we might face post-operative challenges such as massive subconjunctival hemorrhages, suboil hemorrhages, but one should not lose hope here. The patient here was post-diabetic vitrectomy. He developed massive subconjunctival hemorrhage and he was quite worried, but two further cycles of heparin-free dialysis, the hemorrhage resolved and he was feeling better. And again, the patients tend to be on dialysis or have a prostatic hyperplasia or post-stroke, make sure they have empty bladder before they are shifted on table so that we need not panic at the end of the surgeries. And surgeon should know the machine, its parameters, and also take help of the preoperative aids such as OCT to identify the cleavage planes in a diabetic vitrectomy, to localize the location of the foreign body by using X-ray, CT scans, to know the preoperative PVD status in case of dense VH and post-trauma cases. Neck positioning is not just for patients, even for the doctors. One should not overextend or overflex, because in the long run, you will not be able to flex or extend either way. So make sure your neck is in a straight gaze. And before starting the case, check that the microscope eyepieces are centered to the neutral or desired refractive status. You know the parameters, how fast the microscope is moving both in XY or up-down direction. See that the microscope is well centered so that you will have full range of movements during the operative procedure. Make sure you are using sterilized instruments so that reduce the post-operative infection risk. One should be aware of the instruments required in the case. Most of the time, surgeries tend to be done in with the lights turned off. So both the surgeon and sister should know where the instruments are. All the liquids are kept at one end of the table, and other routinely used cutter, light pipe, and scissors, forceps are kept at the other end. So before starting the case, before putting the cutter inside, see that it is working. Here, instead of guillotine action, we can see that the inner cylinder is completely popping out. So this won't cut the vitreous, instead it will cause the vitreous traction. And most of the times during endo laser, we tend to forget whether the laser filter is turned on or off. That should be checked. And before complaining why the laser is not coming, see whether the fiber optic cable is working functional or not. Here it is reaching only till the half of that cable, so at whatever power settings, we will not get endo laser. Intraoperative aids such as packing of the nasal bridge or use of viscoelastic to keep the cornea moist is essential. So make sure you have viscoelastic on the table. Sometimes we might require an iris riposter or Tuck's knife to clear the corneal epithelium for improving the visualization. In some special situations, in addition to the routine instruments, we might require to decide the choice of instruments, such as in suprachoroidal detachments or patients with dense VH where we don't know whether we are in the vitreous cavity or not, a 6 mm cannula might help. Or in patients post cataract surgery, day one, soft eyes, we might require to use an MVR also to make an entry. If the patient has anterior concomitant anterior segment manifestation like subluxated cataract or IOL, make sure before the case itself you have a keratome on table, a monofilament nylon suture, a crescent blade, Simcoe cannula, so that you save the time and avoid shouting in between. In cases of foreign bodies, make sure you have the foreign body forceps or an intraocular, extraocular magnets with various forceps are available. Serrated edges tend to do when cases of a foreign body to prevent the ricochet effect. And some certain special situations like diabetic vitrectomies, make sure you have a chandelier so that bimanual surgeries can be done, which might help the surgeon. And in cases of buccal vitrectomy, make sure the cryo probe is functional. There's a fully filled gas cylinder and you have all the band buccal segments before you start the procedure. And last but not the least, we have our own humble needle, which can do multiple works of a pick, as well as it helps to identify the cleavage plane, induce PVD, diabetic vitrectomies. So once we are having all the instruments on table, we have checked everything, we are all ready to proceed ahead with the surgery. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sriram. We'll move on to the next presentation and then hopefully we'll have more audience who will take the questions at the end. We move on to the next speaker, Dr. Dharmeshkar, understanding of new vitrectomy cutters.
Good morning, everyone. I'll just explain about the two new cutters, what is being there in the market. One is the Bevel 10K cutters by Alcon, and one is the Vitesse hypersonic cutters. Now, newer advanced 10K Bevel cutters is not only the things what we have seen the evolution over a period of time, that it has grown from 5,000 to 7,500 and 10,000 cut rate. Or it's not just only increase in the cut rate, but whole fluidics and duty cycle has changed for the newer cutters. It works on the dual pneumatic drive technology, as we are aware. And it results in the fewer iatrogenic break than the spring-driven probe. And it's reduced the vitreoretinal traction and efficiently more vitreous removal through the port open time via duty cycle or cut rate adjustment. So that's a very important factor, and we have a graphs for that. Now, this increase the added versatility because it's access to the more of the tissue plane. We can go very close to the tissue and retinal surfaces, and it's allow the segmentation and delamination, which reduce the dependency on scissors or forceps. So itself, with the help of cutter, we can able to do many things, and which increase the efficiency. Now, if we are know that Bevel probe, which increase the surgical versatility, especially in the diabetic patients when we are going very between the membrane and the retinal surfaces, it acts like a spatula. It allows the access and creating the space between the membrane and the retina. And it like vertical scissors also, where we can cut and do segmentations. It controls the delamination of membranes. Now, compared to the standard probe, because of the Bevel's age, we can go very close to the surface, and it's more with the 25 and 27 gauge. Now, port to retina proximity, if we see, in 23 gauge, we can go 55% closer to the retina, and in 25 gauge, we can go to 47% closer to the retina. So it's increased the efficiency seen with the higher cut rate, which is a less resistance to the flow, and more tubing compliance are there. This is the graph which compares the longer port open time by changing the duty cycle. So in the 23 gauge, the difference is 52 to 57% from 7,500 cutter to 10K cutter. But if we use 25 plus or 27, it's from 49 to 61% and from 49 to 60%, where it's very remarkable difference we can feel during the surgery. The same BSS flow comparison was done, and it's more with the 10K cutters and vitreous flow at the maximum cut rate in the core mode, so which is also increased in 23, 25, and 27 gauge cutters. So the bevel tip designs allow the cutting port close to the retina. It reduces the traction and provide the increased efficiency of the surgery. The second new cutter which is there, but it's not commercially very much available, it's only with the Bausch & Lomb Stellaris, no financial interest, but it's a hypersonic cutter. If the tip pulsated 1.7 million times per minute, the port 100% time remains open, and which they claim there is a very less traction and the flow is much more. So which is exceptionally controlled precision is there. There's a consistent flow because of 100% port open time, and a complete unabsorbed aspiration novel single lumen design is available. Sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Dharmesh. The next speaker, as all of you know, what is most important for any VR surgery is visualization. So we have Dr. Raju, who talks to us about wide angle viewing systems and how to get a focused image.
I'll just briefly tell you about how you can go about getting a focused image. First, we need to understand the what are the viewing systems that we have. That's the contact and the non-contact. And among the non-contact, which are more commonly used, is the Oculus type biome and the ReSight. And you also have the eBio systems. So contact wide-angle viewing systems are the most affordable viewing system. You just have to buy the lens and the inverter. But only thing is you require a very good assistant to assist you during the surgeries. And the focusing is very easy in these cases. Just have to put the lens, invert it, and use your microscope to focus. That's all. However, when you go to the non-contact viewing systems, every viewing system has got a different focusing method. The ReSight, Biome are more commonly used. I'll stick to them. Rest of it, Office works on a different principle, and eBios also is totally different. So I'll be telling you more about the ReSight and the Biome. So the advantages of the contact, we all know you get a very good image resolution and stereopsis. However, you cannot move the globe too much when you're using a contact wide-angle viewing system. However, you get a wider field of view compared to the non-contact systems. Other less commonly used are the PWL lens and the 132 adapter. These are attached to the headrest of the patient's table. However, these are slightly bulky and they're cumbersome. Although I have developed an adapter for using it to the microscope, still it is nothing, although you get good quality images, but it's nothing compared to what you can get with ReSight or the Biome. So the difference here, what you have to see is that you have the lens, that is the high adapter, 132 adapter high resolution lens, and a condensing lens. So this is attached to the head of the microscope, and adjusting the distance between these two lenses is what gives you the focus in a Biome system. While in a ReSight, the lens doesn't move up or down. You have the focusing system within the blue color adapter there, what you have. There you have the focusing lenses. So you have to move this knob here to get the focused image. So just the Biome, how it is there. So what you have to do when you are going to use a Biome, the first thing is to reset your microscope to X, Y, and zero. Then once you're done, then put a visco, and then focus on the limbus now. Focus on the limbus, and adjust the Biome wheel up to the maximum level. After you're done that, then go down and with the maximum zoom, or at least more than the mid zoom, focus on the limbus. And once you have focused the limbus, then put the lens into position. After you put the lens into position, then reduce the magnification and just try to get the lens down to get the till you get the focused view. Now, once you have got the focused view, it's important that what you have to do is to, if you want to increase the field of view, you have to press the focus foot switch button in a Biome. So pressing the focus foot switch will not lead to a focus. It will lead to movement of the whole microscope up or down. As the microscope moves up, the field reduces. As you go closer to the cornea, the field increases. And the ideal distance should be around 8 millimeters approximately between the cornea and the lens to get the correct focused image. As far as ReSight is concerned, the focusing mechanism is slightly different. So you have the inverted tube. What you can see here is, this is the Biome system, the ReSight system, and the focusing lenses are within these two, within the system. Here you can see the wire here, which is motorized. Now what they have done in ReSight 700 is, they have combined the microscope foot switch and to the motor of this one. So as soon as you pull the lens into the system, the inverter gets activated in the reset. So as soon as you activate the reset, the inverter gets automatically activated, and the lens doesn't move up or down here. The lens is at a particular distance. This is only to prevent for patient protection, this disc. So, and you can rotate it in any direction that you want. And when you press the focus here in ReSight 700, the focusing happens here because the movement of the lenses happen here. That you have to do it manually in ReSight 500. So that's the only difference. And if you want to switch to the macular lens, that's the green lens, you just have to swivel it. And here again, you have to remember the distance that you have to maintain. It's a 60 diopter lens, so you have to go slightly away from the cornea when you are focusing this lens. And you should not go closer. If you go closer, the stereopsis reduces. So these are the small things that you need to remember when you are doing the using both these systems. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Raju. Now I invite Dr. Rohan to present.
Well, very good morning. Lucky to see all these people in the early morning breakfast session. I'll be just focusing from absolute basic aspects of the things, not going into minutest of the details as Dr. Raju went into. I'll just speak briefly about the contact lenses only wide angle viewing system for vitrectomy surgery. Well, absolutely no financial disclosures to make, but we do acknowledge having research grants for multiple institutions. Basically, this is an handheld irrigating contact lenses that neutralizes the high convergence of the corneal curvature that focuses onto the retina in the vitreous. The basic lenses are the plano-concave lenses. They are used for the macular part, and they view approximately 20 degrees of the field of vision. The biconcave lenses, they view the 30 degree of the lenses, and the prism lenses, they have the meridional view of 60 degrees. This is just for the basic general ophthalmologist to come accustomed to the things. The contact lens wide angle viewing system, this is the diagrammatic presentation of the irrigating lenses, the contact lenses, and the non-contact lenses. They all have a different field of view. The conventional viewing system, as such, they have a very low cost, and they have a non-inverted image. So you don't need an inverter to be fit into the microscope. And sometimes when you are viewing a non-contact viewing system with an inverter, then you have to switch the inverter on and off every time you switch for a general microscopic view to a retinal view of an inverter. It has a very less learning curve for the surgeon and has an excellent resolution also. But the disadvantages would be the limited field of view. That's a major disadvantage. Peripheral retina can only be seen with the indentation only. That has a less alignment problems. But when you have an air bubble or a blood film, especially during the diabetic vitrectomy, is when you have a surface oozer, that blood film will come beneath the lens system and they'll obscure your view. So it has a very poor visualization in small pupil, and in view is very compromised when you have a corneal surface disorders like an opacity or the haze. Basic lens system, I'll just show you the video. This is a sutured ring. Then you have to suture the ring. Previously this was used very widely. Right now also people are using these systems. And once the ring is sutured, that prevents the movement of the lenses over the surface of the cornea. And when you have a smaller eye, then it becomes difficult to have the ports and the everything, and the maneuverability will significantly reduce with these lenses. So the equation differs in the air-filled eye also, so you have to be careful and be remember about the things. When you have a fluid in the eye or you have an air in the eye. These are the different contact lenses. This is a ring. This is a mini quad lens, and the ring which is being placed is basically not sutured, but it gets glued up and has a very significant wide field of view. This is a Voke Optiflex surgical lens where you have you need an assistant either to hold the lens properly, and that assistant needs to be very rightly trained or a seniorly trained people to help you out, and they can move and maneuver the lenses with your wish and with your commands. So either you can have a trained assistant, or you have a suture or a silicone ring to put your lens in proper positions. These are the other contact lens viewing system. I'll not go deeply into the detail of the every system, but these are the various other wide angle viewing system, that is a vitreous panfundoscopic lens, the contact wide field system, the advanced visual instrument system, and the re-inverting operating lens system that has a Clairvit or an HRA Voke optical lens. Dr. Raju has gone into detail of the advantages and the disadvantages of various contact and non-contact methods, so I'll not go deep into it. So basically, to conclude the summary, the lenses, the contact lenses used in the retina are for the diagnostic values. They are digital wide field lens. They are used for the slit lamp diagnostic retinal screening, even through a non-dilating pupil. The digital high-mag lens that is used for the examination of the nerve fiber layer, the macula and the optic disc, and digital 1X, that is optical disc measurement and photographic recording. These are the contact lenses used for the diagnostic purposes. For the therapeutic purposes, the HR wide field, that is a pan-retinal photocoagulation lens for the diabetic retinopathy, and the screening for the retinal breaks and the tears. And the HR centralis, that is being used for the focal or the grid laser for diabetic macular edema and evaluation of the macular holes. Well, thank you so much to spare your time on this morning.
Yeah. Thank you, Rohan. And I request Dr. Anusha to present.
Very good morning to all. Dr. Nagender was supposed to cover this topic, but he is unable to make it in the last minute, so I'll be talking on this instead. So the topic is core vitrectomy, PVD induction, and scleral indentation. Well, we did have to look at the different vitrectomy systems, the 23, 25, and 27 gauge. Since it has not been discussed, we'll probably have a small kind of a discussion towards the end, where we have around 10 minutes for panel discussion about the differences in the vitrectomy systems. So before we move on to what is vitrectomy, we need to understand the anatomy of the vitreous, and we need to know what we need to remove. So first, we have, as all of you know, there's an anterior hyoid, and then you have the vitreous cortex, the posterior hyoid, and what in the center is a vitreous core. So when you do a vitrectomy, we would be addressing all these one by one. So without wasting any more time, I would move on to the video. And when we start off with any surgery, what we start off first with is a core vitrectomy. The parameters during core vitrectomy are the suction and the cut rate. You can have a high cut rate and a high suction as well. Again, what is more important to remember is during core vitrectomy, do as little as possible so that you have more of vitreous chunk left so as to hold it and to grip it and pull it off the optic disc. This is the PVD happening. Now, PVD, it can either be a triamcinolone assisted, or you can even do, so this is, so the PVD can even be, you may use triamcinolone to aid the visualization of the posterior cortex, or you can even use it unaided. So I prefer to use triamcinolone. And the maneuver that is generally, so the maneuver, so how you pull the PVD off is generally, when you try to engage the vitreous is generally engaged at the optic disc, on top of the optic disc, at either of the margins, preferably nasally. And then you try to rip off the optic, the attachment of the vitreous to the optic disc. So the maneuver is again a tangential and an anteroposterior movement. So you hold it tangentially so as to rip it off the optic disc and then pull it anteroposteriorly. Then you can even extend the maneuver to either of the quadrants. What is more important is to watch the anterior wave, like in this video. the anterior wave, because that is where when you encounter traction or any lattice or any hemorrhage, you'll have to stop. So closer look at PVD induction. You hold the hyoid stuck in the optic nerve margin, and you try to pull it a little tangentially first along the arcades. And once you see a wheeze ring coming off the optic disc, you try to engage it further. And then you can see the anterior wave progressing forward. You also try to engage from all other directions, try to pull it. So you can see the wheeze ring ripping off the disc, and there we have a PVD. Now, once you have detached the posterior hyoid from over the optic disc, subsequently, you can even lift it anteriorly. So what I do is first lift it anteroposteriorly, and then lift it in all the different quadrants, inferiorly, superiorly, nasally, and temporally. And then you finish off the vitrectomy. So first, we've done the core. We've done the core to reach the posterior hyoid. You've lifted off the posterior hyoid off the retina. And now what is left is the remaining cortex, which can easily be removed. So in some cases, the PVD might be difficult with a cutter. So in such cases, you might want to use a bent needle, or you might want to use a pick to make an opening in the hyoid. So this is a pick. You have been successful in creating a defect there. And if through the defect, I try to induce my PVD. Such is generally helpful in cases of vitromacular traction, where sometimes the PVD may be densely adherent, and you might want a small pick to create a hole and then pull it off. In some cases like this, you might even want to use a forceps to lift the PVD off the disc. So you can use a cutter, you can use the pick or a bent needle, or even the forceps to aid you in a PVD induction. So, once the PVD is done. Now, what is more important is, which is neglected, is you have to come back once you finish the vitrectomy to also remove the anterior hyoid. Why this is important? This is important in diabetics and also in retinal detachments. Now, as regards to scleral indentation, these are the few steps that need to be followed. You have to remain in the vitreous. You keep the probe away from the retina. You exercise special precautions in phakics. You try to bring the probe parallel to the retina so as not to hit the lens. And what is more important is also to watch for the optic disc pulsations during your scleral indentation so that you can reduce the infusion pressure when required. So my last, the points to discuss would be the precautions while you take a PVD. So point one would be to switch off the cutter, keep the aspiration high so that you can engage the vitreous. The pull is general tangentially and anteroposteriorly. So while you grip the vitreous, you ensure that you've gripped only the vitreous. In a case of a detached retina, you try to keep the probe away from the detached retina so that you don't hold the retina. And I would like to ask, sir, would you like to do a scleral indentation in all cases, or would you like to restrict it to retinal detachments? So what is your take on that? Right. So once you're sure that your PVD induction is complete, so I guess you can restrict the base shaving and all such invasive procedures to cases of retinal detachment alone, or a combined retinal. Another more important thing in scleral indentation and sometimes in fakics, you can tend to hit the lens. So there are certain maneuvers which help you to not hit the lens. It is one is you try to visualize the shaft of the cutter always when you are doing a vitrectomy. So you indent more and you advance your cutter less so that you can avoid hitting the lens, and also not cross the aura, because once you try to cross the aura again, there's a chance of hitting the lens. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Anusha. I'll request Dr. Amol to present.
Good morning, everybody. So in the era of vitrectomy, basically everyone is doing more of vitrectomy for retinal detachments. But once in a while, it's good to have a tight buckling. Yesterday was Valentine's Day, so a good tight buckling from the girlfriend is very good once in a while. So scleral buckling, once in a while, it's good for fresh detachments with minimal or no PVR and phakic patients. We usually avoid scleral buckles in advanced PVR, macular hole, and posterior breaks. So buckling is a creation of an inward indentation of the sclera. Its main purpose is to close the retinal breaks by opposing the RP to the sensory retina to reduce the dynamic vitreoretinal tractions at the site of adhesions. So first, we'll go to the basic surgical anatomies, which will be helpful in doing the procedures. So the layers of the conjunctiva since the peritomy is required. So conjunctiva and the anterior tenons, and then the intermuscular septum around the muscles, beyond which is the bare sclera. And the insertions of the recti muscles, which forms the spiral of the tilok. So it is corresponds to the position of the ora serrata. And the vessels, different vessels, the anterior ciliary arteries usually run over the recti muscles. So it's easy to identify the recti muscles by their positions. And important to know the position of the vertex, ampulla, and the vein, which is usually around the either side of the vertical recti. So it's better to avoid any manoeuvres in this region. Otherwise, and even while locating the muscles, it's better care has to be taken not to be gone very posterior. Otherwise, we may hook the vertex vein and injure it. Before going into the OT, it's very important to make a very good indirect ophthalmoscopy examination and note all the breaks and make it on the retinal drawings. Mark the special landmarks like pigments and the blood vessels in relation to the breaks, so it's easy during the surgery. Breaks can be usually are around the according to the Linkoff's rule. Anesthesia usually peribulbar anesthesia with lignocaine, bupivacaine, and Hylase. It's in case of uncooperative patients and pediatric patients, general anesthesia is used. So when we start with the conjunctival peritomy. Usually, it's done 3 to 4 millimeters. Beyond the limbus, the first, because since it's the conjunctiva is very adherent to the limbus, the first radial incision cut is made at 3 to 4 millimeters. Then the scissors are used to, with the horizontal movements, you can just separate the adhesions to the sclera. And the circumferential limbal peritomy is done with relaxing incisions. And then while slinging of the recti muscles, we can dissect the intermuscular septum between the recti, and then we can pass the special muscle hooks with the eye and sling the muscles with braided 2-0 silk. Care has to be taken while slinging the superior rectus muscle, because the superior oblique muscle runs from temporally beneath the superior rectus, so many times the superior oblique might be slinged. So it's better to sling the superior rectus from the nasal side, which avoids the superior oblique. After slinging all the four muscles, we have to check for scleral thinning areas in between the recti. So in the areas of scleral thinning, better to avoid any maneuvers like suturing or even cryo, which can lead to sometimes rupture. Then localization of the break by indirect ophthalmoscopy. We can put a mark with the pen or a Trifan blue and localize the external position of the break. It's important. Many times radial position of the break is mistaken because of the parallax if there is a lot of SRF. So in this figure you can see the actual position of the break is B, but it's visualized as much lower down. So to avoid that, in case there is a lot of subretinal fluid, we can do a drainage first and put an air bubble inside and then proceed with cryo and explant. Then treatment of the retinal breaks, it is by the cryotherapy, which produces effective pigment epithelial retinal adhesions. And the RP and the overlying retina should be treated together for firmer adhesions. The cryo is done on the apex and the horns and contiguous break. So initial, when there is a lot of SRF, the initial reaction, the RP starts whitening first, which looks like dirty white. And then when the retina and the break gets whitened, it then the whole cryo is over. Care has to be taken for the accurate placement of the cryoprobe tape. Many times because of the shaft indentation, which the tip might be at the posterior pole and which might cause the cryo of the macula or optic disc. To avoid that slippage of the cryoprobe, we can give counter traction from the opposite by holding the recti muscle from the opposite sides. So different buckle materials used, usually it's a silicone tire or a sponge, and 240 bends is a circumferential scleral buckle. The configuration depends on the brakes. So radial, large horseshoe tear, the radial buckle is preferred. The length and the breadth, length of the radial buckle depends on the length of the tear, that is the distance between the horns and the apex, and the width depends on the distance between the horns. And segmental circumferential buckle, the length depends on the width of the brakes, and the width depends on the length of the brakes. We can augment encircling band in case of tire or radial buckle. So this a mattress suture is taken to fix the scleral buckle. It's usually a non-absorbable 5-0 ethibon, and the suture is taken. Anterior suture is taken along the lines of the insertions of the muscle. Posterior suture is usually taken at around 9 millimeters because the 7 millimeter is the width of the scleral buckle. And the circumferential 240 strip, it can be fixed either by partial thickness scleral tunnels, or it can be fixed with mattress sutures. In the end, the after placing the buckle and the strip in the groove of the buckle, the first temporary sutures are taken, and the strip can be tightened with a Watske sleeve, or it can be tightened with a claw hitch knot. Then the important step is drainage of subretinal fluid in case of large bullous detachments. The usual sites preferred are along the horizontal recti, and depends on the even the height of the SRF. So with the scleral with a crescent blade, we make a nick in the
Dr. Amol, I'm sorry to interrupt, but yeah. We're running short of time. Can you please conclude a little? Yeah. Thank you so much.
Then sclera is dissected till the choroid is seen. A diathermy is done to the choroids to avoid any bleeds. And then with the spatulated needle, we can perforate the in the subretinal space and drain the fluid, and basically we can drain it till the pigments come. Care has to be taken not to drain at the site of the breaks, otherwise there can be vitreous and retina incarceration. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm sorry for interrupting, but I think you're running short. So we have our next speaker, Dr. Rajesh. He is a consultant in vitreoretina and ocular oncology at Shankarai Hospital, Bangalore.
and he'll be talking to us about the basics of RD surgery or vitreoretinal surgery.
Good morning, respected teachers and dear colleagues. Chachapon, it's basically not, you know, tailored for seniors like you. It's more for myself to relearn my basics and for younger colleagues, but whatever that I have prepared, I'll just put forth in front of you. So this is basics of RD surgery. So first and foremost point for any surgery to start up is to make ports. As we all know that we have three standard ports for passpana vitrectomy. One is for the infusion and the other two is for the handle to, for the light probe and the vitrectomy cutter to go in. So basically what we do is, like, in some situations, which I think Anusha madam had already told, like if at all you have a diabetic or any other cases where you need an extra hand for you to support, so you can put a chandelier that will be a four port where the light is independent of your maneuvering of your hand so that you have both hands free for bimanual dissection. As far as the sites are concerned, if a patient is phakic, the usual port is done about 3.5 millimeter from the limbus, and if it's pseudophakic, about 3, and if it's aphakic, maybe 2.5 to 3 mm from the limbus. That's the standard sites where you make the ports and do, go on with your vitrectomy. Before you go ahead with the vitrectomy per se, you have to always confirm that whether your infusion cannula is properly placed and it's into the vitreous cavity. I'll just replay this video. The first is the infusion cannula. Two more ports, and I take the light and then depress partially to see whether the end of the infusion cannula is visible. There are certain differences which I would make to what Dr. Anusha had told. She told, like, you do the anterior vitrectomy at the end to make sure that you have completed, but usually we prefer, at least I prefer, to do the anterior vitrectomy and vitrectomy around the ports before you go and do the core vitrectomy or the posterior vitrectomy. The reason behind is there are possibility that when you are maneuvering the forceps in and out, or your cutter in and out, or your light pipe in and out, you might cut a port side dialysis. The next is, once you have done the anterior and core vitrectomy, obviously the process is you go and attack the posterior hyoid or the vitreous, the PVD induction. Madam has already covered in detail about it, but anyway, I'll try to do. This is a patient, a young patient, where the vitreous is very adherent and it doesn't seem to just yield to the suction that I'm giving over there. So in regular cases, you can do as madam had elegantly demonstrated, but in certain conditions like this where it is very adherent, you can always use a forceps or even a passive suction from a flute can be done. You need to, the classical teaching is you need to have a Fishtack sign or some kind of elevation at that point, then you continue with it. What I generally do is go all around the disc and try to give active suction to my cutter and try to peel it out. If that doesn't happen, then use a forceps, stain with a tricot to identify the posterior hyoid and then peel it. Even needles can be used sometimes to pick up an edge, and from there you can continue inducing the PVD all through. See, this is basically an RD process that I am doing. So once we are finished with the PVD induction, then you continue with the core vitrectomy and completion of the break localization. So I have identified the break. It's a single HST with a flap over there. So the retina detachment is quite bullous. You try and tend to do some amount of fluid exchange at this point of time so that the retina goes back a bit, and then you cut the vitreous all around the break and as much as possible anteriorly. The free flap is cut because the vitreous traction is basically at that point. So when you trim it and then continue the vitrectomy anteriorly to the break. The edges are cauterized to make sure that the vitrectomy is completed all around the break. So you don't want any form of or any foci of traction by the vitreous, residual vitreous, which is around the break. So this is what I'm doing right now. So all around the, you can see there is a lattice in that break. So I'm just going and trimming off all the vitreous all around the break and the lattice inclusive. In the process, you might, whatever the retina which is attached might get detached, but that's not a point to worry about. The whole point is to clean the vitreous all around the break and the lattices and free up the complete edge so there's no foci of traction which is left over. Once you have completed the break localization and the vitreous completion, so then we attack the PVR. So sometimes when it's quite bullous and it's free, the retina is very mobile, then you can use a third hand, that's the PFO, the PFCL, which has been placed to stabilize the posterior pole, the disc and the macula. Once you have peeled the PVR from the posterior edge, then you go attack anteriorly and keep on filling the PFCL little by little so that the entire retina, posterior retina is flat and completely stable, and you can attack the anterior vitreous and shave it as much as possible. As Dr. Anusha had said, you can indent and try to peel the entire vitreous up to the base. So identification of a star float is very important, where you can go with the forceps or a needle and nip it up and then peel the using a pick forceps or an engrafting forceps or a serrated forceps or a max grip forceps, whichever is convenient to you. BBG might sometimes yield, like if you can't find out very flimsy membranes, PVR, which is there on the retina, which is very much adherent, which can cause recurrence, you can always inject BBG in the posterior pole and see that that area is negatively stained and try to pick it up. Epiretinal proliferation should be tackled first and then look at, into your subretinal gliosis, SRGs, sheet SRGs, or for tractional bands, then you can either cut it out or peel it out completely. So most commonly, there are not accessible, so you make a small retinotomy just above the SRG and then cut it loose. Or if it's too long and too taut and pulling the retina, then you need to pull it in toto or break it up into pieces. So once this is achieved, so your retina is very much mobile now, it's quite supple and retinue get attached completely. The lens process of it is, you do an air fluid exchange. First you do a fluid-fluid exchange, try to tilt the eye as much as possible so that you avoid a posterior retinotomy. In this you can see it's very, very anterior. Despite that, we could fairly achieve a complete retinal attachment without doing a posterior retinotomy. So basically I've done is tilt the eye a little bit and make it dependent area so that you do the air fluid exchange and completely remove the fluid, and then do the laser photocoagulation all around the break and the lattices. So there are some lattices which are very much seen in the same area. They might be in opposite areas also. So you tend to laser all those areas and make sure that it's well photocoagulated. So choice of tamponade depends upon where is the break and what is the extent of retinal detachment. If it's a superior break, you can very well use gas and get away with it. If it's one-eyed patient or you want the visualization immediately post-operative, it's better to use oil. Oil is also preferable in other conditions like extensive PVR, inferior breaks, complex retinal detachment, or retinal detachment associated with conditions like ARN, PVR, GRT, all these conditions, it's better to use oil where you want a fairly long tamponade to be in situ. Thank you. Any questions or anything? Yes.
Thank you, Rajesh. Can you just briefly, quickly mention the settings for peripheral vitrectomy, because I think that's something I missed out on. So the suction and the cutter, how it works was to avoid peripheral breaks and interface vitrectomy.
See, the maximum what your machine can give you, the cutting rate, that would be the best. So keep your cutting rate at the maximum and the suction as much as less. So in my machine, which I use Goiter, I use a cutting rate of approximately anything more than 3,000 cuts per minute, along with a suction less than 100 when I'm doing a peripheral base shaving. As far as the posterior vitrectomy or the core or the anterior vitrectomy, majority of the situations, I keep a suction of about 200. And cutting rate is, you can moderate between, if you want a faster, to surgery to complete where you're not very much worried, the retina is completely flat, you can keep a low cutter rate also, maybe around 2,500 to 3,000 and complete it off. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rajesh. I'll request Dr. Anirudh to present now.
Yeah, good morning, everybody. I will be discussing about recurrent retinal detachment surgeries. In fact, it has been a great session, and we have studied all the steps of a retinal detachment surgery and what is then basics of recurrent RD surgery. In fact, basics of recurrent RD surgery is nothing but a permutation and combination of all the things that we have studied just now. So what is recurrent RD surgery? Something that occurs after a primary surgery. When it occurs, if it occurs early, it is called as primary. If it is occurring late, then it is late. So primary and secondary. What are the risk factors? Most often the risk factors are PVR, missed retinal breaks, and sometimes the primary retinal detachment surgery characteristics itself. So the following table will show us how do we manage recurrent RD surgery, because we have already seen the steps of basic RD surgery. It is nothing but the same steps applied to this protocol. So if recurrence has occurred after what Dr. Amol discussed, that is scleral buckling, in that case we have to see where the missed break is, or if there is a fresh break that has occurred. So if there is a missed break or a fresh break, then we can either do a revised scleral buckling or we can use a pneumatic retinopexy procedure. However, if it is not just a missed break but a PVR that is developing, or if it is a detachment which has occurred late, in that case then we have to choose vitrectomy. So in the basics of recurrent RD surgery, we have to have a protocol in which we choose the surgery. That is more important because we have already learned the steps of retinal detachment surgery in our previous talks. If the detachment has occurred after vitrectomy, then we have to see again if it is related to the tamponade. So if we have used gas as a tamponade, we can redo the vitrectomy, inject again a gas which is a longer acting gas, or we can choose to inject a different type of tamponade, that is silicone oil. If the detachment has occurred with the silicone oil in situ without a PVR and an open retinal break, then we can do silicone oil fluid exchange, do laser again and repeat injection of oil. If the break is not supported, if there is inadequate retinopexy done, then we can add to it. However, most commonly the detachment occurs because of PVR. The PVR has to be then managed. It can be managed either under the oil itself, or we have to remove the oil, redo the vitrectomy, remove the remaining PVR. If there is some amount of PVD which has not been done, do it and then repeat it. Many times nowadays only vitrectomy is done as a primary procedure for detachment. In that case we can augment it with a scleral buckling. Sometimes retinal detachment can occur after silicone oil removal. In that case we have to see if there is any residual traction or if there is any missed break and manage accordingly. So I think we are running quite short of time, so I will go fast. So this is revision of buccal. Sometimes we use pneumatic retinopexy. For PVR, repeat surgery is a standard. We have to do a meticulous vitreous base dissection. The smaller gauge vitrectomy surgeries have significantly helped us, and the advances in the vitrectomy cutter, the visualizing system, perfluorooctane, all of these have helped in significantly improving our surgical steps. We can use special staining dyes to highlight the membranes which are to be removed. These help in removing the remaining PVR membranes which tend to cause the recurrent detachment. Sometimes we can even peel the internal limiting membrane, as we will be seeing in next sessions. Retinotomy and retinectomy can be used extensively, and also we can use different types of tamponades for our recurrent retinal detachments. So sometimes in this video we will see how we are doing a membrane peeling under silicone oil. So this is membrane peeling with PFCL helping to stabilize. So we are removing the membrane under PFCL. So how do we choose between scleral buckling or revitrectomy? Many times it depends on the epiretinal membranes or whether the tear is not supported well. Which are very high risk eyes? The highly myopic eyes are very high risk of having recurrent retinal detachments. and we need a scleral buckling in most of these cases in addition to a vitrectomy. We need to do a proper ILM peeling and many times use silicone oil as a tamponade. So now, in spite of advances in our vitrectomy instruments, there is still an incidence of recurrent RD. It not only causes a lot of economic and emotional burden on the patient, but also reduces the prognostic implications. However, whatever is the case, according to me, we should attempt a repeat surgery, because in many cases, especially those who are one-eyed, it gives at least some amount of ambulatory vision. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Anirudh. I'll request Dr. Gopa. Sorry for giving him the...
Stop. Proliferative diabetic retinopathy is a common indication for vitreous surgery. And in this short video, we will be demonstrating how useful small gauge MIVS is in the management entry with 25 plus system is either biplanar like this, or it can also be uniplanar with a significant oblique incision like this. The new design of trocar and the vitrectomy probe with the suction at the tip provides great efficiency. In dense vitreous hemorrhages like this, a preoperative ultrasound is of great importance, as this will clearly delineate the hyaloid from the underlying retina. After the hyaloid is cleared, after we see the disc and the posterior pole, we finish the surgery with laser photocoagulation. In cases with retrohyaloid bleed, we use the probe to cut on the already detached hyaloid. Here we were trimming all around the central island and finally trim the central island itself. After the hyaloid is entirely separated from the retina, now we will address the retrohyaloid bleed. We use the silicone tip backflush to slowly take the bleed off the retinal surface. In some other cases, it may be difficult to detach the hyaloid, as in this case. Here, we would try to catch up the hyaloid from an elevated area like a hemorrhage and then induce a PVD from there. Here is a more difficult traction with the fibrous membrane just abutting the retina. Here the 25 gauge probe can go in and actually cut, or rather shave, the traction very close to the retina. In this case, there is a separation of hyaloid from the retina in the temporal quadrant. Centrally, there is a tight fibrovascular attachment. Slowly delaminated off the macula and then segmented with a probe. When we use a small gauge probe, we can use the probe to insuinate between the areas of traction and trim it further to reach the end result. When the dissection is very difficult, sometimes we put a PFCL bubble to reduce bleeding. In cases of secondary rhabdomyosarcomas retinal detachment, removing the hyaloid, we use a fluid-fluid exchange to remove the subretinal fluid. After that, an air fluid exchange is completed. This is a taut posterior hyaloid which is lifted up by a 25 gauge forceps and removed in the fashion of ILM peeling. This is yet another membrane which is taken out from the arcades, and with repeated grips and regrips, we take the membrane all out to the periphery. This is a case of proliferative diabetic retinopathy with macular hole, where we are removing the internal limiting membrane. You can see that after ILM peeling, the hole is almost closed. Silicone oil is injected in specific cases. This is anterior hyoidal fibrovascular proliferation, and this is cutting of the AHFVP, which may cause bleed.
I think we'll conclude this session for want of time, and
I would like to thank everyone for coming so early in the morning and attending the next session. Thank you very much, and thank you, MPS sir.